We are in a new year, in the Christian year. Advent is the beginning of our liturgical year. And this year, the gospel that we focus on is the gospel of Luke. And I wanted to just give a little bit of background into understanding the gospels before I go into today's story. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are called synoptic gospels because they are basically telling the same story. John's gospel tends to not be part of that because he has brought in a completely different tradition and a completely different perspective on Jesus and his identity. So when we use the gospels in the Christian year, we use Matthew, Mark, and Luke as the traditional readings, and John gets inserted from time to time through Advent, sometimes for Christmas and Easter. Matthew, Mark, and Luke have common source material, and that's why they're very similar. If you go back and look again, Mark does not have a nativity story. The Gospel of Mark begins with Jesus' baptism. Matthew and Luke carry the nativity, and they're completely different stories. So, often when we have Christmas pageants, we meld the two stories together, and we have shepherds, which are Luke, and we have angels, which are Luke, and we have wise men, which are Matthew, okay? So, each of the Gospels has a different focus for Jesus and a different reason for telling the story. Mark presents Jesus as the Son of God, the performer of mighty deeds, who has been sent as the salvation of Israel. Mark is most likely the first written down gospel, and a lot of the material in Mark is borrowed from Matthew and from Luke, is by Matthew and Luke. Oftentimes, if Mark differs from Matthew, he's similar to Luke, and where Luke differs from Matthew, similar to Mark, there's a way they kind of come together that indicates that Mark is actually a source material for Matthew and Luke. Matthew is a gospel that is directed towards the Jewish people. And when you read the story, the things that happen are said to happen to fulfill prophecy. Matthew uses the words of love, the law. And this was done to fulfill the prophet. And this was said to fulfill the prophecy. Okay, so for Matthew, Jesus is the fulfillment of prophecy. And he is the leader of the new Jerusalem, the new Jewish people. Luke was a physician. Luke traveled quite extensively with Paul, and Luke was a Gentile. And so his story is quite different. He has the material that Matthew has, and he tells a lot of the same stories, but he has a very different focus. Luke's gospel is often called the gospel of the poor. It is often called the gospel of women, and it's often called the gospel of Gentiles. Because Luke sought to make the story of Jesus available to Gentiles and Jews. And he felt that Gentiles had a place in God's kingdom, that it was not just for Jewish people. Also, women figure very prominently in Luke's gospel, more so than any other writing in the New Testament. And one of the people that Jesus confronts is a woman who is also from Samaria, and Samaritans were not considered part of that promised group. And so Luke, by introducing a female character from Samaria, reaches out beyond the boundaries of what Jewish people might at the time felt comfortable with. So Luke has a very broad focus. And what I love about preaching this particular Sunday from Luke is the absolute richness of the story of the women, of the two mothers. Now, if you miss a little bit of the backstory, Elizabeth is married to Zechariah, who's a high priest in the temple. And she is they are an older couple, and she is barren, she's never had children. And within the Hebrew community, that is considered an affront. It is considered having been overlooked by God. The womb is a powerful, powerful image in Hebrew literature. And when the womb is closed, you are cut off. You're disenfranchised from your people. And this story is very common. Think about Abraham and Sarah. And Sarah was very, very old when she became pregnant with Isaac. Rachel and Leah, the two wives of Jacob, and Rachel was barren and was, again, and the word is remembered by God. God remembered her, and she had two children. Samuel the prophet, his mother's story is the same. She was barren, her husband had another wife who was bearing him children, and she could do nothing. And God remembered her, and she bore a son named Samuel, who then she then delivered to the temple to serve God. So we have this tradition of women and their wombs. Very powerful stuff. And Elizabeth is in that tradition. She's old, and she's barren. And God says, you actually doesn't talk to her. He talks to her husband and tells Zechariah that his wife will bear a son who will be the prophet and the announcer of the new kingdom. Okay? So, Elizabeth is about 6 months pregnant when Gabriel comes to Mary and informs her that she is going to have a child by the Holy Spirit. And as soon as she knows this, she makes the trip, which is about a 90-mile trip, to visit her cousin, her kinswoman, her relative Elizabeth. Because the angel said to her, and your relative Elizabeth is pregnant also. And now we know, with God, all things are possible. So you have this lovely meeting of these two women who are carrying within them the hope of Israel. Now, there are only, to my knowledge, two other women in the Bible who have a prophetic function. And one of them is Miriam. After the crossing of the Red Sea, Miriam, the sister of Moses, leaps out with her tambourine and starts singing and dancing about how God has saved Israel and cast the Egyptians into the sea. This is actually one of the oldest existing fragments of Hebrew literature is this beautiful song by a prophetess, Miriam. The other one is Deborah, who was actually a judge, a ruler of Israel before the time of the kings. And she was also a woman who was given a brief prophetic pronouncement, and she was considered a prophet. If you say words that inspire, you are prophetic. Interestingly, one of the commentators on this scripture said that when this little six-month fetus leaps in the womb at hearing the greeting, that is his first prophecy.